It means that I will start with you and then by me.
You and then.
And then you and then by me. No.
Thank you. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Having witnessed the signing ceremonies, we can now proceed to the press conference following the EU Western Balkan Summit here in Sofia today. The three speakers will first give their introductory remarks, and after that, there'll be time for some questions from your side. Without further ado, I first invite the chairman of the meeting, president of the European Council, Donald Tusk, to take the floor.
Thank you, Preben. Good afternoon. Before anything else, let me thank Prime Minister Borisov, his team, especially Ekaterina, Iliana, Denica, but all of your colleagues, your whole team, they did something excellent. I'm really impressed when it comes to your effectiveness, determination, and mainly because of your engagement, we can say today that the summit was successful. And of course, thank you for the wonderful Bulgarian hospitality. Blagodarya Bojko, Blagodarya Prelesna Bulgaria. We have just concluded a very good and fruitful EU Western Balkan summit. I believe that it took us too long since our last meeting in Thessaloniki 15 years ago, and this is why we decided to meet again in 2 years in Croatia. This is the best illustration that the integration with the Western Balkans is a top priority for the EU. Today, we reaffirmed our mutual commitment to the European perspective for the whole region. As I said during my recent visit to the region, the European Union is and will remain the most reliable partner of the entire Western Balkans. And in very concrete terms, we discussed how to improve connections with and within the Western Balkans region. We are speaking about human, economic, digital, and infrastructure connections. The package of measures we signed a while ago, the so-called Sofia Priority Agenda, adds new initiatives to our current cooperation. For example, we agreed to double the Erasmus Plus to allow more youth to study in the EU. We agreed to work towards the lowering of roaming charges, and we agreed to create more favorable conditions for private investments by providing better bank guarantees. And to avoid any confusion, let me be very clear. The connectivity agenda is neither an alternative nor a substitute for enlargement. It is a way to use the time between today and tomorrow more effectively than before, so that our citizens and businesses are not waiting for all the benefits of EU integration. Because I don't see any other future for the Western Balkans than the EU. There is no other alternative. There is no plan B. The Western Balkans are an integral part of Europe, and they belong to our community. Before concluding, let me very briefly comment on EU leaders' meeting yesterday evening. We agreed that the EU will step up its efforts on digital and innovation in order to rise to the challenge of technological revolution. You should expect very concrete decisions when we formally meet in June. They will include elements like the establishment of a European Innovation Council in the next MFF, pilot projects including for artificial intelligence and more funds for investments. All this will be based on our European values, including full respect of citizens' privacy, also online. As to the Iran nuclear deal, we agreed unanimously that the EU will stay in the agreement as long as Iran remains fully committed to it. Additionally, the Commission was given a green light to be ready to act whenever European interests are affected. Finally, on EU-US trade. Also here, we have achieved a united approach that will strengthen the Commission in its ongoing negotiations with the US. The EU is even ready to talk about trade liberalization with our American friends, but only if the US decides an unlimited exemption from steel and aluminum tariffs. President Juncker will present our approach in more detail. Thank you.
Thank you. I now invite Jean-Claude Juncker, the President of the European Commission, to take the floor.
Thank you, Donald. And once again, I would like to join the large camp of those who are congratulating the Bulgarian presidency for its numerous efforts and for the excellent organization of the meeting we had yesterday and today. As we are running out of time, I have to be very brief because we have to take our planes in order to continue our work in Brussels. Monsieur Liron, d'abord, tant que les Iraniens respecteront leurs engagements, l'Union européenne, évidemment, s'en tiendra à cet accord dont elle, l'Union européenne, fut un des co-architectes. Mais nous devons savoir que les effets des sanctions américaines annoncées ne resteront pas sans effet. Et donc, nous avons pour devoir, Commission et Union européenne, de protéger nos entreprises européennes et notamment les petites et moyennes entreprises. Hier soir, j'ai été encouragé par le débat qui fut le nôtre, puisque les propositions que la Commission a soumises à la méditation des membres du Conseil européen furent intégralement suivies par les chefs d'État et de gouvernement. Nous devons maintenant agir. C'est la raison pour laquelle nous lançons le processus de recours à la loi de blocage, blocking status, de 1976, qui vise à neutraliser les effets extraterritoriaux des sanctions européennes dans l'Union européenne. Nous devons le faire et nous le ferons demain matin à 10h30. Ensuite, nous avons décidé de permettre à la Banque européenne d'investissement de faciliter l'investissement des entreprises européennes en Iran. La Commission, elle, maintiendra sa coopération avec l'Iran. Le commissaire de l'énergie, M. Cagnetti, se rendra dans les 48 heures à venir en Iran pour poursuivre nos échanges avec les autorités iraniennes. On trade, that means on the trade situation between the US and the European Union, I have to be very clear once again, and I'm repeating myself by saying it. We want an unlimited exemption from the proposed tariff measures. If Europe obtains an unlimited exemption from the proposed tariff measures, we are ready to engage in talks with our transatlantic partner, meaning by there that we want to deepen our energy cooperation, notably on liquefied natural gas. We want to focus on voluntary cooperation between regulators on both sides and on an ad hoc basis outside the framework of trade negotiations. We are ready, together with the US, if they so want, to discuss a reform of the WTO organization. And lastly, we are ready under the condition that the exemptions will be permanent. We are ready to discuss how to best improve reciprocal market access, notably for industrial products, including cars, as well as the liberalization of government procurement. But let me repeat, we will not negotiate with the sword of Damocles hanging over our hats. It's a matter of dignity and it's a matter of efficiency. Thanks.
Thank you. And now I invite Prime Minister Boyko Borisov of the Bulgarian Presidency and the host of the summit to take the floor.
Уважаеми колеги, първо искам да благодаря, да се извиня за всички софиянци, за чудовищния трафик, който създавахме, но още един ден, тъй като не знам дали преди е имало толкова много президенти, премиери, канцлери, банкери, ръководители на европейски институции да се съберат в България. Така че извинявайте, но мисля, че ползите за България са много повече от това да изстрадаме тези два дена. Искам да благодаря на всички лидери на Европейския съюз, които до един дойдоха, както и тримата големи. Антонио Таяни го няма в момента, защото тръгна, но председател на Европейския парламент, на Европейския съвет, на Европейската комисия. Това е едно уважение не към мен, не към правителството, това е едно уважение към българския народ. И аз мисля, че крайно време всички в България да чуят и да разберат, че това е председателството на България и когато то е успешно, България е успешно. Никой не помни имената, помнат думата България като успешно председателство. Вие видяхте на първия ред преди малко да си стискат ръцете президента Вучич, президента Тачи, да подписват 6 президента договори, интерконектори. Нещо, което само преди години беше дори невъзможно да си го представим, невъзможно да стане. Имахме една много добра дискусия, много честна. Може би Жан-Клод Юнкер е доста по-напред от мен и Доналд по европейските съвети. Аз отдавна не съм слушал така без лицемерие, а толкова честно да си говорят толкова от сърце, толкова искрено тези, които са за и тези, които са против. Различните писти, бързина и скорост на присъединяване на Европейския съюз, на страните от Западните Балкани. Дадох един елементарен пример, ще ви го кажа и на вас. Защото толкова страхове, толкова приказки, особено в западните медии. Ако Западните Балкани олицетворяват една страна, тя ще е по брутен вътрешен продукт 96 милиарда евро. За да сравните, това е брутният вътрешен продукт на държавата Словакия. Сиреч днеска всичките тези два дена радости, тъги и усилия, които полагаме, е да приеме все едно икономика, колкото Словакия, с население по-малко от Румъния. Просто това го казвам за западните медии. Населението на Западните Балкани е 17 милиона и 700 хиляди, брутният вътрешен продукт 96 милиарда. Е това ли плаши Европейския съюз? Това ли са големите страхове? Не е ли по-добре тези хора да са в преговори с Европейския съюз, техния политически елит да се старае да покрива всичките критерии или да ги оставиме съответно другите геостратегически играчи да дойдат и разбира се да усилят и не малкото си в този момент влияние, което имат през мюсюлманите, православните християни или ангажиментите, които след войната в Косово отделни държави все още имат. Така че до края на юни пак ще имаме възможност да си говорим, но така или иначе много теми за размисъл сме си задали. Мисля, че всички се тръгнаха от тук с по едно на ум, както българите обичаме да казвам. Иначе с нощи най-важното, защото то касае пак и днешната среща, Европейския съюз, лидерите, Европейския съвет, а и сутринта мисля, че тази символична разходка, която направиха Тереза Мей, Макрон и канцлера Меркел по моста на влюбените и дойдоха пеша заедно, е доста символична, както и снимката между Тачи и Вучич, както и добрата новина, която споделиха Зоран Заев и Ципрас, че в скоро време може би ще научиме. Или се договорили. Но това си техни тайни, които ще разкрият първо пред тяхната общественост, след като я споделят. С една дума, за всички стана ясно, че с проблемите, които имаме, с големите геостратегически играчи в света, единственото спасение на Европейския съюз е да бъдем един. Или както Ангела каза, един лист да не може да мине хартия между нас. И мисля, че вчера го усетих, сутринта го усетих, че вече сме осъзнали, че силата на Европейския съюз е в това. Солидаризирам се за всичко, което колегите казаха преди мене, за да пестиме време. И съм много щастлив, че видяхте колко споразумения на Западните Балкани лидерите им подписаха, включително и интерконекторите. Надявам се до края на годината и с Гърция интерконектора да го започнем като първа копка с Алексис, това сме си го обещали. Благодаря.
Thank you very much. The floor is now open for your questions. We have standing microphones to ask your questions. And the first one goes to the gentleman here in the middle. Please, sir.
Методи Владимиров, Нова телевизия. Видяхме сближаване на отношенията между Гърция и Македония, един огромен успех. Има ли нещо обаче, което ви притеснява в останалите западно-балкански държави? И в този ред на мисли, господин Туск, казвате, няма план Б, Балканите са част от Европа. Много от тях обаче се надяват на срок 2025 година. Доколко това е реалистична дата? Благодаря ви.
We have to discuss about substance, not about dates. And the substance is up for me, at least, absolutely clear. I can only repeat that historically, geographically, mentally, culturally, this region is a part of Europe. And for this, we need also some political consequences. We didn't pretend today that everything is clear and simple. This skepticism in Europe when it comes to enlargement as such, not because of this very region, but enlargement as a political phenomenon, it's obvious. And I have no doubts that we will witness also in the future mainly problems and also arguments, but the process, this trend, this tendency is absolutely clear. All of 28 our colleagues, leaders, were yesterday and today aware that we are talking about the European perspective for the region. But it's not our intention to spoil this process by suggesting something unrealistic like, you know, fast track or something like that. And I agree with Prime Minister Borisov that we have to assess the whole problem in the right proportions. I mean that Europe is big and strong enough to adopt the whole this idea and this project of enlargement with all problems and consequences. But of course, when we are talking about numbers, about statistics, it's not a big deal. You're right, it's economically it's like Slovakia. But frankly speaking, especially after my visit, and I was almost everywhere in this region in the last 2 years, more than 35 visits only in the Western Balkans in my role as a president of the European Council. And I should say, Bojko, that okay, maybe GDP and demography shows that it shouldn't be a big problem, but if we compare this region to other parts of Europe, we can say that when it comes to troubles per capita, Western Balkans are much bigger than, for example, Germany and France together. Yeah? And this is why I think we have to be consistent, tough, optimistic, but also cautious with our promises. But today, what I feel, and it's clear, I think, for all of us, that it was a next and very serious and significant step in this European path for the whole region.
Thank you. Take the next question. Ladies to the right.
Аз искам само да благодаря на Жан-Клод Юнкер и на Доналд Туск, че преди тази среща намериха време да обикалят Балканите, всички държави. И това беше много полезно днес, защото със своите впечатления, заедно с комисара Хан и госпожа Могерини, доста така осветляваха нещата в сферите, които колегите не ги познават. И разбира се, да напомня, че сега продължава вече в истинска работна обстановка с банките, които са тук, съответно с министрите, които са тук, с премиерите. Много от президентите си отиват, идват премиерите им за утре за срещите, за да може реално да се тръгнем от тук с готови проекти.
And now we turn to the lady to the right. Microphone.
Говори.
Okay.
Okay. Thank you. My name is MOK Babiak with the German press agency DPA. And I would like to ask you about the trade liberalization, of course, if the permanent exemptions are granted. Could you elaborate on these four areas? And have you heard back from your U.S. partners on this possibility? Thank you.
I have to tell you that we had no representative of the U.S. governor on the table yesterday night, so I don't
know.
Unfortunately. No. Unfortunately, says Donald, but nobody was there. So we'll see what kind of reactions they will develop. The four points are very clear. I don't have to elaborate on them because they are like a poem. They are speaking for themselves, and this poetry language is well understood in Russia.
Okay, thank you. We take a third question. Yes, the gentleman in the upper right corner.
Lauren Cook from the Associated Press. A question on Iran, please.
Where?
To the right.
Over here?
Yeah.
President Tusk, you said you were looking for European unity. Could you tell me what kind of unity you were talking about beyond just defending and protecting this deal? President Juncker, you mentioned the blocking statute, and it seems quite complicated. Perhaps for me, no expert at all, but my reading of it, it seems a little bit contradictory in some places and actually puts pressure on European businesses. And just more generally, it's kind of surreal, isn't it, to see Europe cooperating with Iran, a regime that's been very unpredictable in the past. And now you have issues with the United States, a long-term ally. Is it time to rethink the way that you do business with the United States? Because in the end, this just helps other countries, perhaps Russia, China, even Iran itself.
Thank you.
No, as far as this decision we have taken yesterday night to launch the process of the blocking statute, I can only refer to what we have done in 1996. That was in a US-Cuban framework, and we'll do exactly the same. We have to protect our companies, we have to protect mainly those who bona fide, mainly small and medium-sized enterprises did invest in Iran, and we cannot let them alone. So what is important is to avoid these non-territorial impacts the American measures could entail.
If you allow me just one more, as you wish, one more general remark, political remark. It's, you said that the problem of Iran in the past, but also maybe today and tomorrow, was and this unpredictability. I think that the real geopolitical problem is when you have not an unpredictable opponent or enemy or partner. The problem is if your closest friend is unpredictable. It's not a joke now, and it's because I think this is the essence of our problem today with our friends on the other side of the Atlantic. Because I can agree with President Trump when he says that unpredictability can be a very useful tool in politics, but only against enemies or opponents. unpredictabilities in my opinion, the last thing we need when we are friends inside family. And we have no illusions and no, you know, high expectations when it comes to Iran and their approach towards the EU or the Western world. But we have the highest expectations when it comes to Washington. And our intention, our opinion is to continue this closest cooperation with this administration. But for this, we need less capricious assertiveness and more predictable and consistent approach. In fact, when you assess last 3 or 4 months, we should talk about every aspect of geopolitical context today. I hope that our unity in every aspect, economical, political, including military and defense, this is our main tool, not only versus opponents, but also with our friends today. And this is why it was so important for all of us to demonstrate yesterday and today that we are able to, in fact, establish a new quality of unity among 28 member states.
Thank you. We take one last question, and I see the gentleman to our left.
Michael Peel from the Financial Times. To follow up on the point that you were making there, President Tusk, there have been suggestions that the EU countries are going to continue to explore putting more pressure on Iran about ballistic missiles, its regional role, and other matters, which is what the US always wanted. And can you see that this is something that is tenable, that in a sense Europe, having been humiliated by the US on the Iran deal, then just goes back to the table to discuss once more the US agenda?
I can agree with you, but maybe we should use not this term, American agenda, but our common agenda, because I still believe that, especially in such a difficult issue like Iran, we should believe that we can still talk about our common agenda. And you are absolutely right. It's not only an American obsession, but also a European obsession. We need Iran in this deal as a reliable partner. And for the EU, it's absolutely obvious. It's in our common interest to have a real control on this process. And it means that still the United States are possible closest partner here.
Thank you very much. This concludes the press conference. Thank you for attending.
Thank you. It was.
Non l'ho sentito, ma lo riassumo. is that for? Okay, can I help you?